This is For Keeps, a podcast about collections and connections. I'm David Peterkofsky. This is a collector's story about a man who's dedicated much of his life to capturing the unique and multi-layered heritage of his homeland, a place he left as a teenager but never lost sight of. It's a story that brings new meaning to the phrase, home is where the heart is, particularly because this collector's home could double as a museum that showcases the complicated legacy of a nation that, in terms of its culture and influence, still has his heart. This is still an okay time to chat?
It's a great time.
Okay, great.
You find me filing, so oh. I'm in the mood.
The collector, or filer, in question is Emilio Cueto. Emilio's in his late 70s and lives in Washington, D.C., and for the past several decades, he's relentlessly pursued his passion for collecting all things related to the history, culture, and heritage of Cuba. And when I say all things, I'm not too far off. When are you not filing?
When I am buying and when I'm writing. Those are the three activities in my life.
Emilio, who's never married, is a retired attorney, the author of several books on the history and influence of Cuba, and likely the biggest individual collector of items that document his homeland's past, including objects that originated within Cuba, as well as things he's collected from around the world that reflect the sights, sounds, and stories of the Caribbean island nation. All around Emilio's densely packed but well-organized home, there are bookcases, cabinets, and shelves filled with historically significant items, ranging from biographies and newspapers, to maps, coins, and stamps, to menus, tobacco tins, and bottles of rum, and even the occasional gunpowder container. His large collection of porcelain dishware may come from Europe, but its imagery of typically Cuban scenes is what compelled Emilio to collect it all in the first place. Those global echoes of Cuba, far beyond its shores, are of particular interest to Emilio. It makes sense, given his history. He came to the U.S. in the early 1960s, shortly after the failed Bay of Pigs invasion, and as part of the Central Intelligence Agency's Operation Peter Pan, when Cuban parents sent 14,000 children to live in the States, away from the Cuban Revolution and Fidel Castro. From his vantage point outside of Cuba, Emilio's long been fascinated by looking back at his native country and how it's perceived internationally. Whether it's on dishes, on cigar boxes, in poetry books, or even in recordings of TV's I Love Lucy, if it relates to Cuba, there's a good chance that Emilio's got it represented in his apartment. Actually, I should say his two apartments. More on that later. Emilio's upbringing in Cuba's capital city was comfortable, but as fate would have it, not without its challenges.
Well, I was born in Havana of middle-class parents. My father was a lawyer, and my mother was a housewife. And I had a sister, and so we had a small family. We lived in a very nice section of Havana called Vedado, which is a beautiful section in Havana. It's a good neighborhood. And then tragedy struck very early because my father died when I was five. It was an accident in the road, and my mother almost died. She was also in the car. And that, of course, changed our lives dramatically. My mother never remarried, so she devoted her time to us. And then I was lucky enough, because my father had attended one of the best high schools in Cuba, the Jesuit school in Cuba called Belén. My father had gone there, and I got a scholarship in honor of my father to study there. So I was very lucky that I went to that prestigious school, and it set me in the right direction.
The family's fortunes, along with those of many Cubans, changed considerably at the end of the 1950s when Fidel Castro came to power.
In 1959, the Cuban Revolution took over the country, and in the beginning, we were all very excited. And soon, for some people sooner, for others later, it became a nightmare in many ways because it did not respect the promises of democracy it had made to the public in order to gain the acceptance of the revolutionary movement. And I was very involved in the Catholic movement. I was in a Catholic school, and particularly in the eye of the revolution were people who were religious and committed to a different way of organizing society, democracy and freedom of speech and freedom of religion. So my mother became very concerned, and eventually she pleaded with me so that I would leave the island. I wasn't too interested, but she persuaded me. And eventually I ended up joining what's called Operation Pedro Pan, which is a U.S. government-financed operation to bring young people from Cuba under 17, under 18, actually, and then find them a temporary housing here and temporary schooling with the expectation that Castro would not last too long, and then we would return back home. It was a way to give peace of mind to Cuban families who could not leave the country because either they had their own parents or they had some business or they had, I mean, people just don't leave the country without great reason.
Because Castro remained in power, those unaccompanied young people stayed in the U.S., many of them eventually being joined by their families. But in the case of Emilio...
My family was an exception, or at least not the most common path, because they remained in Cuba. And remaining in Cuba changed my life in many ways, because I left like with a rear view mirror as to what was happening. Some of my friends and classmates who came, and the family soon joined them, many of them lost interest in following affairs in Cuba because it was more academic and theoretical than personal. But obviously, in my case, with my family remaining there, it was a matter of communication, of family. My concern about Cuba was more than just as a student.
As a student in the U.S., Emilio studied political science with a focus on Cuba. And it was then, as a young adult, that he began collecting.
The beginning of my collection dates to, I came to the U.S. in 61, so the beginning of my collection dates to that time, not expecting to have the collection I have today, but obviously books that had to do with the politics of Cuba and the history of Cuba, because I was studying political science. At least I wasn't going to study Greece or Argentina or India. I was going to study Cuba. So at the beginning, I would get a lot of books about Cuba. And eventually it occurred to me, it was obvious from my own experience and from what teachers said, you know, everything has a context. You cannot study Cuba just the military or political event. Literature is related. Music is related. Visual arts is related. Everything is part of a package. The country doesn't exist just in the military barracks or in the White House. So eventually my collection grew to include every single aspect of Cuba.
As he began to collect items relating to his homeland, one element of his burgeoning collection became clear. Emilio realized that within Cuba, residents had been kept in the dark about the influence of Cuban exiles around the world.
The government of Cuba made a terrible decision, among the many terrible decisions they have made, which was to exclude from the knowledge of Cubans inside the island the entire cultural output of Cubans abroad. They would concentrate on anti-communist activities and the exiled community as a political entity, but we would not be included in the music achievements or the literary work. And I was extremely concerned that that part of our presence here or abroad, I mean, not only in the U.S., but in Mexico or in Argentina or in Spain, the people in Cuba would not have access eventually to these things. Because when years pass, these materials, especially the ephemera, tends to disappear. You cannot just 20 years later saying, oh, I made a mistake. Now let's get the books of whatever or the records. No, those things just are out of print. It's very difficult to start going back and assembling a collection after some events have happened. Books get out of print. Records also get out of print. The playbill for the particular theatrical performance is gone. So that's another aspect which made me concentrate also on the work of Cuban exiles.
One thing led to another, leading Emilio to envision another collection he could assemble, one that would illustrate how the ripple effect of Cuba's heritage has served as inspiration to non-Cubans.
It could be an American writer or an American musician or an American painter who paints about Cuba or who makes a song about Cuba. And then that aspect of the Cuban echo abroad became very important in my collection. And I take great pride of having a huge collection of music composed by foreigners about Cuba, of literature, poetry, narrative, and theater about Cuba. These are of foreigners who got inspired by Cuba or some aspect of its history and write a novel set in Cuba or make a poem to Cuban independence or whatnot. So that's basically the way it's grown my collection.
It sounds like your motivation initially was personal, but then it sort of expanded to preserving this stuff for other people to enjoy as well.
Absolutely correct. What became as a personal thing for me to find things became an obsession, I would say, to make sure that these things are not lost. My collection is really a combination of three things. It's objects, it's books and printed material, and then it's clippings. So, for example, at one point in my life, I purchased the yearbook of Britannica Encyclopedia. Every year, Britannica had the summary of what happened that year. I used to live in New York Strand Bookstore, which is one of the best bookstores in the country, would sell them for 50 cents. So I would buy 10 years, of the yearbook of Britannia, and I would go in and would look for the section on Cuba, and I would rip that off. And I would go to the section of sugar, and I would rip that page off. And I would go to the section of nickel, and I would rip that off. Tobacco, items that I would know that Cuba had content on. And then I would file that piece of paper in the appropriate folder in my house. So as a result, I have thousands and thousands and thousands of clippings from newspapers and from books that which I tear apart, or magazines. If a magazine has one article in Cuba, for example, Time Magazine, I will take out the section on Cuba and I would file it under, let's say, chronology, or if it's a particular event or a particular person, it would be under the biography file. So for every person, I have books and a corresponding file with clippings. That's how my collection works. The one element that it's common, it's Cuba related. But after that, everything goes. It could be a recipe for a Cuban sandwich, or an old map, or a recording, or a medal from the time of the Spanish-American War, or an engraving, or a pin, or a stamp. The reflection on Cuba everywhere, and in every material, and in every time, and in every language, even if I don't speak the language.
And then there's Emilio's porcelain collection, which reflects Cuba's allure as exotic, mysterious in some ways, and in the U.S., ever-present.
The porcelain is divided basically into two categories. One is which the image on the plate or on the piece is Cuban. And the other one is the image is not Cuban, but the name of the pattern that the maker has used is Cuba. The first is explained by the fact that we had several lithographers in the 19th century who made beautiful images of Cuba, and they eventually ended up in Chinaware, in England, in Spain, and in Holland, of all places, taking the images of Cuban views and setting it into porcelain. And then the other group, which is even more fascinating, is when the image is geometrical or just a beautiful design, but the manufacturer has bet that the name Cuba or Havana will sell, because Cuba sells. For many reasons, Cuba is exotic. You have an embargo. It's close. It's 90 miles away. A lot of people in the generation before us went to the honeymoon in Cuba. We had a ferry that would go to Cuba. So Cuba is very close to the U.S. In fact, no history of the U.S. can be written without Cuba, because the U.S. intervened in our war. The U.S. botched the Bay of Pigs, and the missile crisis took place down there. So at least those three topics end up in every history book of the U.S. So Cuba is very familiar to a U.S. reader. I remember taking an airplane once, and I was going to Paraguay, and the lady next to me asked me, "Where are you going?" I said, "To Paraguay." And she paused and said, "I hadn't heard that name since high school." Well, that doesn't happen with Cuba. You hear the name all the time.
Yes. And I'm curious, what type of imagery appears in the porcelain and on the stamps when you talk about Cuban imagery? How does Cuba look visually to outsiders?
That's a great question. Well, in the case of porcelain, the images were made, most of them, by two foreigners, in fact, who went to Cuba in the 19th century. One Frenchman who arrived in 1839 and a Spanish one who came in 1840. And they are really descriptive of the island. One of the advantages of a foreigner arriving in a country is that they're surprised by something that's so common to the native that the native doesn't take the time to record it. So we had a particular dance, typical dance of the countryside, called zapateo. And of course, it surprised the foreigners. We had a cockfight. Cockfights were not known in many parts of the world. And so people arrive in Cuba and see cocks fighting. And that is amazing. So they record that in their visual paintings. Well, on the January 6th, the slaves were allowed one day a year to celebrate, and they were allowed to parade through Cuba in their native customs. And it was a very noisy and colorful celebration. So needless to say, these foreigners would see this parade in Cuba and they would rush with their pencils to paint it. So the imagery in the porcelain is done inside Cuba. The imagery in the stamps is fascinating. It's a little different because, of course, they're much more recent. But they cover every topic. They cover our flowers. They cover our animals, endemic mostly. They cover, of course, the Bay of Pigs. They cover the missile crisis. They cover the Cuban Revolution. They cover some of our most famous individuals, Martí, an apostle of independence, a Cuban exile himself here in the U.S. He lived here a long chunk of his life, and he died in Cuba. He's the foremost leader, political and literary writer in Cuba. We had a great chess champion, Capablanca. He also shows up in the stamps. Interestingly enough, Desi Arnaz, who's probably the most visible image of Cuba in the U.S. before the Cuban Revolution, ends up in stamps all over Africa. You have stamps on the discovery of America because Cuba was discovered on the first trip. So Cuba is present at the two most important events of the Western Hemisphere. On the moment of the encounter between the two cultures, Cuba is there. We are discovered 12 days after the first landfall. And then we are present when that world, which became one in 1492, was almost disappears in 1862 with the missile crisis. So the stamps reflect those two moments. And then we have some of painting and some of music. It's a great variety. Sports people. I mean, Cuba has had a lot of sport success in the Olympics. So some of these people are well known throughout the world.
Mm-hmm. So it's probably hard for you to answer this, but I'm wondering, what would you say are some of the items that you're most proud of having?
Well, for example, I would mention a powder horn. Powder horns were very popular in the U.S. and somewhat in England during the War of Independence here and a little before. They really come up in the 1730s, 40s. And Cuba was invaded by the English and Americans, who were English at the time, in 1762. They took over Havana, and they were there for about 11 months. At that time, one of the material items that were done in society were carving powder horns, horns of animals, which were carved to make them beautiful, which would keep inside dry the gunpowder. Well, because that event in Cuba took place in 1762, several powder horns were made depicting the taking of Havana. And I happen to have a couple of powder horns, very hard to find. I did a research after that, and I found 22 in the world. So to own two of them, it's a great privilege. There's one in the Library of Congress. There are two in the Metropolitan Museum. There's one in Chicago. There's one in South Carolina, I believe. There's one in Boston. So, you know, it's a major piece in my collection. Very rare and very beautiful piece.
How did you get that?
Well, actually, I got it in the Baltimore Antique Fair that take place on Labor Weekend every year. I had recently learned about the existence of powder horns, and I'm there and I see a store called the Powder Horn. So I went in just because the name was familiar, and the guy just happened to have purchased it a week before. And he said to me, the only reason I have it and I haven't sold it yet is because my clientele looks for American images and I don't have anyone looking for Cuban images. So it was really a great piece of luck to find that. Very rare.
Of course, you make your own luck too.
You're right. I mean, I am very persistent. I got a letter about a year ago from some dealer in Pennsylvania saying, since you have been my most consistent Cuban collector ever, before I put this in my catalog, I give you a first refusal, you know, the possibility to buy it first, which was very nice. It's a tribute to my persistence going everywhere. I have a dear friend, a Cuban professor in Pittsburgh, who went to Brussels, and he was in a little town outside of Brussels. I went to an antique shop and found a map. And he said to the guy, I'd like to purchase the map. And the guy said, no, we're waiting for Emilio Cueto from New York to respond to our offer. So he was so, he laughed so much. I mean, he's in this little town in Belgium. And they knew about me because I had left my name every place.
Certain books in Emilio's vast collection also rank highly among his most coveted finds.
I remember purchasing a very valuable book, probably the most important book in my collection, which is a 1787 book on fish in Cuba, the first really printed book in Cuba. And I got it in London from one of the major book dealers in the world. And when I purchased it, the guy said to me, I know you buy it because it's Cuba, but at that time, there was no place in the New World that a book of this quality was ever made. Even in the context of Philadelphia and New York and important printing houses of the New World, he said nothing was done comparable to this. So, you know, it gives you a sense of context to your purchase.
There's some publishing history in there as well.
Yeah, sure.
And it sounds like you're buying a lot of these things in person.
Well, most of my life, it was purchased in person. In the last few years, of course, because of the ability of doing it from internet and eBay and other sites in England and in France and in Spain, I also collect a lot of things from those sites. But the bulk of my collection was done in person.
The internet did, however, lead Emilio to score a particularly personal Cuba-related item from all the way across the pond.
I have found in internet a chamber pot with a Cuban image of the 19th century. And of course, it's the only chamber pot with a Cuban image that I know of. So I wanted to purchase it. And it was not expensive, but the lady in England who had it, because it's an English piece, refused to send it to me by mail, just refused to. I said, you know, don't worry, I will indemnify you if it breaks. I will send you whichever release you want. No, she would not. So, because I considered that it was important for my collection to have a chamber pot, since most of the things you have in porcelain are chinaware, it's harder to find that type of thing. I decided I was going to France in that summer, so I decided to go to England and then take the channel to France.
England's a long way to go to get a chamber pot, but I guess, as they say, when you gotta go, you gotta go.
That was good. When you gotta go, you gotta go. But let me tell you, it's the only one in existence. So how do you value something in which you don't know any other one? I had that image in plates, but how many chamber pots do they make? It's a great conversation piece when people come and see that and say, wow.
Can you talk a bit about how you keep track of what you've got and what you're searching for? I understand you've evolved from your days of tracking everything in notebooks. Is that right?
I did. I evolved because the technical support has evolved. As soon as the digital world came around, I wrote things in digital form. It was a floppy disk and all of that. And I would print it once a year and I would travel with that. Eventually, a Palm Pilot arrived and I was able to switch from a big bulky book to a little item in my pocket. And then eventually, you know, the intelligent phone came in and now everything is integrated in my phone. Whenever I buy something, the first thing I do is that I go to my computer and I would make the entry of that book or of that music sheet or of that poster or that tobacco label, or that stamp. Because otherwise, I run two risks, either purchasing it twice or passing up an opportunity. I need to know relatively quickly whether I own something or not. Actually, I've evolved. My list includes not only what I own, but what I don't own. For example, I have an author which has 10 books. I put three asterisks to those books which I don't own. It allows me two things. One, to know that I don't have that book. But also, if in a particular author I have nothing, and in another one I have 9 pieces of the 10, well, maybe it makes more sense to spend my money in buying the book of an author in which I have nothing than to buy the 10th book of someone I already have 9, because then my collection would be more representative. It depends. But I do have, as I said, whenever I buy something and it arrives in my house, the first thing I do is I go to the computer, and of course, I save it. And it's in the cloud, and I have access to it in my phone. When I'm in a bookstore in Cuba or in Spain or in England, I can say, okay, let me see if I have this book or this magazine or this whatever. And then that way I know what action to take.
With a collection as comprehensive as Emilio's, tracking everything is only part of the challenge. The other part is storing it all, a challenge that Emilio ultimately handled by taking the apartment next door.
I moved 30 years ago from New York. I thought I had a lot of space, and I did. And of course, my collecting habits, they seem to grow with age, so I eventually needed more space. It happened that my two apartments were connected by a single corridor, so they gave me 10 feet of corridor and sealed both apartments into one, so I don't have to leave one apartment to go to the other one. And both are full. One is larger than the other, but nevertheless, it's really a full place. you need a classical trained dancer to walk through the halls.
But it's all orderly. It's all in order.
Yes. Oh, yes. I am the poster boy for Post-it. Throughout my house, you see little Post-its with letters and with years so that I can find things very quickly. My books are assembled by topic. So I have a whole section on, let's say, visual arts. And, of course, you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G by name of artists. And my music collection, again, you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G. I devote a lot of time to putting things in order. That's what I'm doing right now. I do it all the time, but eventually, you know, when I'm writing a book, when I'm doing something else, what happens is that I don't have the time to file. So the filing gets a little lost in my activities, and eventually I have to take over and start again.
Uh-huh. Is it true that you store items in your kitchen?
I have two kitchens. So I store items in, actually I store items in both kitchens, but in the second kitchen I have my cookbooks. Don't you think that makes sense?
Absolutely.
And my menus. I thought it was appropriate that the kitchen would have cookbooks and menus.
Uh-huh. So do people ever casually suggest that you should maybe find someplace besides your home to store all these items? And if so, what do you tell them?
Well, there are two reasons. I mean, one is money. I mean, everything costs money. Space costs money. But second is availability. I like to be able to access my collection whenever I need to, either because I am doing something or because I get requests every week. Yes, yesterday I got a request from a friend of mine to have a picture of two singers, Celina and Reutilio, very important musicians in Cuba, singers of traditional peasant music. And immediately I went to my CD collection and to my record collection, and I took pictures of the covers. Took me 3 minutes to find it because they're in order. And then I get another person in Cuba who needed a picture for the cover of a book she was writing on Bacardi. Bacardi is the name sounds familiar because it's the name of the rum company. He's a son of the founder of the rum company, and he was a very important intellectual and the creator of the first Cuban museum. So she wanted a copy of a picture of him to put in the cover of her book.
Emilio's reputation is so great among Cuba scholars, and his collection so vast, he was once contacted by a student in Europe about an exceedingly rare book of poetry.
2 years ago, I got an email from a person from Spain who was doing a PhD on sonnets, I think it was sonnets, from 18th century Spain. And he was looking for a particular book, and he said, there's only two copies in the world that I am aware of. One is in the British Library, and it's misplaced. And the other one is in your collection. And he knew that because a friend of mine at some point writing on 18th century Cuba said that I had that book. And of course, it showed up in the internet somehow. So he wrote to me and I scanned the poem for him. And then eventually he sent me a copy of the thesis.
Hmm. So you're helping scholars everywhere.
I do. And that is one of my most satisfactory activities in my life, to be able to share. I mean, it's wonderful. It's magnificent to be able to do that. I'm trying to share and to make known some of the jewels I have found that in most cases were unknown because people were not looking at those areas or collecting. So, for example, I had a concert in Miami at FIU, which has been very supportive of my work. I had some concerts of, for example, The World Sings to Cuba, and I would get music from foreign composers, most of which Cubans would not know because we know Cuban music. But no one was looking at foreign musicians. And I had an exhibit in University of Florida on the presence of Cuba in ceramics and how Cuba ended up in China and domestic and commercial porcelain ware, having images of Cuba or the name Cuba. I just finished a book on the presence of Cuba in foreign stamps, which again is new because Cuban stamp collectors collect Cuban stamps, but no one had looked into the subject matter of a foreign country having Cuba in its stamp or a Cuban. So it's been a lot of fun.
So you have a collection of stamps that represent images of Cuba, but they're from other countries?
Correct. And that's my latest book. And I had the book. It's a really beautiful book by University of Florida Press. And it has 1,000 images, which is more than I even thought when I started.
As far as Cuba's complicated political history, is it safe to say that your collection isn't especially biased one way or another when it comes to the Cuban government? I mean,
it's one of the things I've made very clear is that this collection is totally neutral, and it has the work of everybody, and it has the opinions of everybody. I cannot criticize Cuba's censor if I have my own censor. So I have books here by Che, both in favor and against, and I have the exile community thriving in my house, and I have topics of every kind. I do not censor. If a Cuban has distinguished himself, hopefully in a good way, but also in a bad way. We had a Cuban who was a murderer of a social club in New York some years ago. Well, you know, he's here because he happened to be Cuban. So I do not discriminate in any way, and certainly not political. Cuba has done that enough already for me to follow the footsteps. It's a very scholarly collection. If you are a Cuban who has something to say or do, you should be here. And I would look for you actively to have you in my collection. If you've done bad things, presumably history, there will be a book that would say that. And if you've done good things, presumably there will be an article or a book or a video or a journal that would say that. But I would try to have you here because you're part of our history. The U.S. has a lot of bad things in its history, and you don't suppress them. You have an African-American museum, and you have a World War museum, and you have things that collect the history of a country, and you assume the bad things and try to move on.
So the Washington Post quoted you back in a story in 2015 as saying that when it comes to Cuba, there's no topic on which you have nothing. I'm wondering if I can maybe shoot some topics at you and see if you can scan your memory banks to see if you've got something related to the topics. First one on my list is baseball.
Oh, my God. I have a huge collection of baseball material. I have a file for every baseball player by name, by last name. I have baseball cards. I have most of the Cuban baseball books. I have prints about baseball. I have stamps that honor baseball people. Yes, I have a lot about baseball.
Okay. How about tobacco?
Oh, my God. I have I just finished last year a book on tobacco labels. I have a huge collection of cigar labels, both Cuban, which I am very proud of, but I'm even prouder of the cigar labels that are done outside of Cuba. That try to fake a Cuban connection. I wrote a book last year on the Havana cigar labels, and I'm scheduled to publish a book this year on the ones that say Cuba, although it's fake. The name of Cuba is only in the label. The cigars are elsewhere. Actually, I do own a very rare, which I purchased in one of these paper ephemera places, a very rare box. It's not even a box. It's a paper label cigarette case in the 1860s. One of the few extant.
Wow.
Yeah. And I have ashtrays of many kinds. Some of them appeared in my exhibit of ceramics. And I have a humidor of the 1920s. And I have cigars. A boxer short of Cohiba cigar pattern. And I have many ties with cigar memorabilia. They're very popular.
I bet. So keeping with vices, how about rum?
First of all, I have a lot of rum bottles. Some of them are still with some rum in it. I have actually very good rum. I have some of it lesser known. Of course, I have Bacardi, which is a magnificent rum. But I have also rums from Cuba, from various provinces, which is also very good. So I have both. And I have labels. I have rum labels from Cuba. As I said, I try to be as comprehensive and as respectful to all aspects of my culture.
Okay. How about I Love Lucy?
I have the entire set in DVD, and I have a beautiful ceramic piece, which is a cookie jar, which represents Desi driving to California in the famous picture in which he's driving to California. And I have a porcelain plate, and I have, of course, the sheet music. And I have, in fact, today I was filing the huge poster of Cuban Pete.
Oh, okay. And last on my list is vintage cars.
Books. I don't have any cars, but I have several books on vintage cars which have appeared in the last few years. There's about five books. One, I think, was authored by Cristina Garcia. And there's a few in the market that have the picture of the old cars. I don't have a car, but I have studies about it. In magazines, I think Cigar Aficionado had a number on cars. I do keep busy.
Yeah, I was going to say the Washington Post was right. You got it all.
Well, in some topics I have a lot. In some topics I have little. But I try to have all topics covered. The more pieces of the puzzle you have, the more complete the puzzle looks.
Yes. So one last question for you, and it's not about Cuba's legacy so much as it's about yours. Nobody lives forever, of course, so I'm wondering, do you have a plan to at some point donate some or all of your collection to a museum or museums?
I do. I have some ideas. My dream is that it would be inside the island, because a lot of my materials had never been to Cuba. Having lived abroad, having concentrated on the echo of Cuba outside of the island, it would be a novelty for Cubans to see how the island was displayed in art, in literature, in music, in general writing, in porcelain, in metal, in textile. Oh, I have a collection of textiles, of shirts and blouses and shorts and everything with a Cuba pattern. And I always think that if I had remained in Cuba, I wish someone would have donated a collection like that to Cuba so that I wouldn't have to go abroad to learn about my island.
Mm-hmm. And there would be some poetic justice, I guess you could say, by having it all wind up back in Cuba someday.
Well, back is really not the actual word, because some things never were there. And that's the point. Many of the things I own were never in Cuba. So the impact would be even greater. I mean, when you have stamps that were made abroad, when you have porcelain that was made, all of it abroad, prints, most of the prints about Cuba were not made in Cuba, because they were done by foreigners. So it's just amazing, you know, when you can show a people how they have been looked at by others.
Yeah, so the echo would make it back to Cuba.
That's it. That's exactly it. You put it right. It's the boomerang of the echo.
Yeah, although boomerangs are from Australia, that'd be a whole other apartment for you.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm running out of space, but what can I tell you?
Yes. Well, Emilio, that's everything I've got for you. I want to thank you so much for chatting about your amazing story as a collector and as a Cuban American, and how those two aspects of your identity have come together again and again over the course of your life.
I'm very proud of both. I've learned a lot from both cultures, and I'm very grateful to the United States for the many opportunities that I've had, not the least of which has been able to purchase my collection.
Yeah, it sounds like it. And next time I'm in D.C., I'm going to stop by for a cigar and some rum.
Please, I have both for you. You'll be welcome.
Okay, well, thanks again.
It's been a great pleasure and an honor to be in your show.
All right, take care.
Have a great day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, in Spanish, the word for library is biblioteca. And fittingly, some Cuba scholars have taken to calling Emilio Cueto's Washington home the Emilioteca, a name that reportedly was conjured up by a friend of Emilio's to honor the one-of-a-kind collection and its owner. But regardless of what you call it, the depth and breadth of Emilio's vast Cuba archive is nothing short of increíble. For Keeps is a production of me, David Peterkofsky. Muchas gracias to Emilio Cueto for sharing the story behind all the work that goes into curating the amazing collection of Cuba-related items throughout his Washington home. At ForKeepsPodcast.com, you'll see photos of Emilio and some of the objects in his massive collection. And in the show notes, there's a link to an interactive digital map of Emilio's home that the Wall Street Journal produced several years back to go along with the story about him that they published. The show's theme song is by Still Flyin, and the closing theme is by Eric Frisch. And, in a nod to Emilio Cueto's passion for tracking the echoes of Cuban culture, additional music for this episode was provided by Tomas R. Einarsson, a jazz bassist and composer from Iceland, who's recorded several albums of Cuban and Cuban-inspired music. How's that for an echo? You can visit the show online at ForKeepsPodcast.com, or follow For Keeps on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at For Keeps Podcast. Thanks for listening to For Keeps. Until next time, keep on keeping on.